There's nothing in there. You just throw it.
I think this is better. I feel better already. All right, I guess we can get started. Hi, I'm supposed to be talking to this, right? Yes, okay, great. Hi, everyone. My name's Ingrid, and thank you so much for coming to Server Farm to Data Table panel. Nathan, I just wanted to thank him personally for asking me to put this panel together. It's a real treat. These are four of my favorite thinkers on this topic, which is kind of broad, but roughly these are all generally we're going to be talking about some of the maintenance systems and operations and visibility of infrastructure. Okay, cool. Maybe that's not how you guys feel about it. That's fine. Infrastructure itself, that can mean a lot of things, and it's very easy to kind of declare any kind of thing, be it at the software, the material level and infrastructure. I think generally the thing that a lot of that we're going to be talking about today are kind of foundational, primarily material stuff that in various ways kind of regulates, reinforces, or maintains kind of the surroundings and one's kind of way of living in the world and being in the world, and primarily talking about how telecommunications and the web relate to those things. And I think one of the things when we were kind of preparing this panel that came up just in email discussion was this trope that comes up a lot in the talking about presenting, visualizing material infrastructure, is this language of you are revealing something that was heretofore hidden. And I complain about this often on the internet. And I feel like the phrase making the invisible visible is a very problematic term for a lot of this stuff, because for a lot of the things that we'll be talking about today, they're not actually literally imperceptible to the human eye. They're actually pretty easy to see. Darius Kazemi, renowned thought leader, responded to this by actually making me a Twitter bot that makes other things not other things. Bearing that in mind, the thing that I asked, so our panelists are not going to be reading papers. This is more of a discussion, conversational sort of panel. I asked each of the panelists to sort of respond to the question of if we accept that the making the invisible visible framing for discussing infrastructures and large systems is not what we necessarily want to do or is not the approach to take, what instead would we be doing and why take that approach? And so each of them is going to talk a little bit about that with a particular material. This was also because I realized they all do such incredible, fantastic work that could not possibly be summarized in 10 to 12 minutes. So I only gave them, very little time. I gave them even less time. But so first, I'm gonna have Jenna Burrell speak about this thing, and I'm very excited about this one.
All right, so I'm going to just kind of set some background about what I have been doing in this space and what I'm now doing in it. For about 10 years, I was doing research on young people, internet users in parts of sub-Saharan Africa. I wrote a book on youth culture and internet cafes in Ghana. Many years after I started that project, I started to get interested in not what young people were doing online and what identities they were creating for themselves and all this kind of ephemeral, seemingly immaterial work they were doing in the digital space, but how the computers in the internet cafes got there. Because they had property tags and it looked like they were coming from universities and in the UK. And one time I found a computer monitor that said it was a property of the Environmental Protection Agency of the US government. And I found that there was this site where young men were recycling and refurbishing computers, and also a site that's actually very famous in the West called Ogbogbloshie, where a lot of this stuff is being dumped when it's finally done and used. I got interested in kind of the infrastructure of computer access in marginalized communities and the continual state of brokenness. So the continual state of infrastructural visibility is sort of the area I'm specializing in. The most recent research I've been doing is in Mendocino County, California, a remote area that hosts some of the kind of critical physical infrastructure of the internet, these fiber optic cables. There's a connection between Manchester, California, and Japan. So just as there's maybe a dozen, I'm not, what is the exact number? On the West Coast.
On the West Coast, how many? So if we're just talking continental US, there's a couple in Washington State. I think that's maybe like three or four.
Yeah, Oregon.
Why is it Nicole here?
Yeah, it's like a dozen or so. But, you know, there used to be fewer. And one of the long-term fiber optic cables is in Manchester, California. There's fiber running all through that area, and until recently, no one had access to it. And so I'm trying to kind of bridge between these questions about infrastructure and questions about access. And in this particular community, those fiber optic cables are very visible. People know exactly where they are. When they break, you know, people lose internet connectivity, not because they have access to the fiber. Sometimes they have wireless access that when you go back to its origins, it's fiber. There are problems where cables like come up through the pavement and create ridges in the road. When there are issues of various sorts, things like weather, kind of all sorts of things affect access and internet connectivity in this area in really interesting ways. So that infrastructure is just constantly visible because as the Ghanaians I studied in West Africa, this community is marginalized from kind of mainstream internet access. So I'm looking at people who take their access issues and think about them in direct relationship to physical infrastructure. So they're thinking about access with direct reference to particular fiber optic cables. And this, these are some articles from the local newspaper, very small town newspaper called the Independent Coast Observer. Here's a good example. If you have a spool of fiber optic cable on the side of the road, people notice. That doesn't pass by, you know, anonymously. And the local newspaper will send someone out to ask questions about it and say, what's this for? Who's laying this cable? Can we have access to it? This is a headline from this piece in 2012. No on-ramp for fiber optic highway. So they're laying cable. It's Verizon is laying cable. I think it was to, you know, provide more capacity for their wireless service. And they just stated explicitly to the newspaper reporter, it's not for anyone to get access here. So no on-ramp. There are other issues around access in this area. So there are people who've actually moved out to Mendocino County to get away from EMF wireless radiation. And so that's what the other article is about. A woman who I've talked to since finding this article, who's resisting the installation of smart meters in the community. And she'd specifically moved to this area because it had poor infrastructure. And she thought it was a way to get away from the intense kind of wireless bath that we're all living in urban areas. So a couple of examples of kind of direct relationships to physical infrastructure in relation to questions of access. And I will pass the mic.
And I think the next slides are of Jen, the wonderful Jenny Odell's work. But I think that this version of Keynote is about to break your GIF, which is the worst. Let's see what happens. Oh, maybe we'll talk about the other one and then I can pull up the other GIF.
Okay.
Does that sound good? Okay, we'll talk about this one first.
Okay, so hi, I'm Jenny. And I am an artist, so I make a lot of my work almost all of my work from internet-based imagery. And then in the last kind of couple of years, I guess, my work has specifically, it's always been about the conventionally overlooked. And that, like, I guess there's a subset of that is infrastructure for me. Like infrastructure is maybe like the most obvious example of something that is hidden in plain sight. It's very easy to think about like walking down a sidewalk and there's this whole other dimension of material that you know is there if you think about it for any amount of time, but most of the time it's just not part of your consciousness walking around. So I think that's kind of what drew me to it in the first place. So I think like in response to this kind of prompt of like, what's another way to think about this other than like it's something making the invisible visible, maybe for me it's more, as an artist, it's more an issue of not perspective. I use a lot of satellite imagery, so that's an obvious example of changing your perspective, but also just attention, maybe. It's just where you direct your attention. And so this image here is pretty indicative of the kind of stuff that I do. This is one man who's in every frame of Street View at the Santa Cruz Beach Boardwalk. And that's because when Street View goes through a smaller kind of area, they have to put the camera in a backpack. And that person who's operating the camera sometimes has to be chaperoned by a park employee. And it's hard to see here, but he's wearing khakis. So I don't think he's just a boardwalk customer. I think he's a park employee. He also has like a little radio. He's in every single frame, and it just takes looking for that guy to realize that he's there and he's part of the kind of like structure of this imaging that's going on. And so that's kind of like I'm way more interested in things that are right in front of your face that you just need someone to maybe like shift the perspective a tiny bit and for you to be able to see it than I am like in sort of like uncovering some highly secretive thing. Oh my God, why is someone calling me? it's that guy. No. And I think that's just like on an aesthetic level, that's why a lot of my work involves cutting things out, because sometimes that's all you have to do is just isolate something. So I do a lot of work where I will take many, many screenshots of an oil refinery and then cut out all of, you know, just remove the ground. But that imagery is not secret. It's Google Maps. Like anybody can see that imagery. It's just that I have done something to it that invites you to consider it for a little bit longer. Also, the image that I'm thinking of in particular, that if you go to my website, it's like the first image you see. I specifically chose an oil refinery that a lot of times you'll see flying out of San Francisco. But when people see this image, they often think that it's from somewhere very far away, or that I've altered the imagery because it's a very weird color. It's bright yellow. But it's really important to me that it's something that was very close at hand the whole time, and then it just took me kind of isolating it to bring it to attention. Although I will say, like, in the last year, I'm kind of having problems with this idea of isolation, because these systems are obviously not isolated, so they are connected to everything else. And a really weird example is that I recently went to a data center that if you look into the distance, there's a coal plant. And this particular data center is really big on its renewable energy. But it's very clear that the only other thing out there is a coal plant. So I asked someone, like, do you get power from this coal plant? And they're like, yeah, we get some power from that coal plant. And it's like, there's nothing else there. It's just data center, coal plant, and then like lines. And so the idea of like this very old technology powering like a very new technology is really interesting, but I think it's indicative. Like, I don't really know how to deal with that right now in a representational way, but these things are all kind of tied to each other, so it's not quite accurate to look at them in total isolation. So, yeah.
You want me to pull up a GIF for
you? Oh, sure, yeah, okay. If it works.
See if we can do it. That's always the question. Will it work? Will it break everything?
I think if you just space bar it,
yeah,
it should work.
Okay.
So, oh yeah. But is
mirror displays real quick and then unmirror them, and that'll probably break everything, because that's what happens at conferences when you do anything to the technology.
I have a good feeling about this. Okay.
So this is a GIF of basically like different screenshots of me proceeding to cut out the San Francisco International Airport. And the reason it looks like additive instead of me kind of cutting it out of something is because it's just the way that I use masks. It's easier for me to do it this way. But in another way, it's maybe more appropriate also because, like I said, I'm kind of, I feel like all I'm doing is, if I'm making something invisible visible, it's simply by presenting it in another context. It was always there to begin with. And like many people have flown out of the San Francisco airport, there's nothing secret about it. But I think seeing it in this format maybe helps you to be able to appreciate and like see the structure a little bit better. And it also obviously implies the amount of time and many, many hours that I spent with this particular image, clicking around it when I did not have a tablet, so I did it with a mouse. Yeah.
Aaron Cope, who is, I like to imagine a different internet, that's the internet that Aaron Cope might build for us, sent me this image half an hour ago. So I'm very curious to hear his explanation of it.
Hi, everyone. My name's Aaron. So the thing about SFO is there's a museum there, and they have 100,000 objects in their collection. Yeah. They're plain people, so like plain people, they love all the swag. Yeah, well, I'll tell you about it afterwards. So my first job in technology, which I'm not going to talk about, I'll just briefly mention that I cut my teeth working for a tiny little mom and pop internet service provider on an island, and I remember the day that I saw the server room for the first time, which was like handmade wooden shelves and a computer just sitting on there with a router, and I was just crestfallen. It's like, wait, what? So the short version of my background is a million years ago, I worked at Flickr, which is relevant. We'll maybe talk about that later. Maps, museums, and then maps again. So the one quick story I wanted to tell now is, so up until, from 2012 to 2015, I was living in New York, and I was working up at the Cooper Hewitt, which is the Smithsonian Design Museum in the Upper East Side. And there's a whole long story about the reopening, but the first thing we started doing was working on the collections website. And the Cooper Hewitt has 200,000 objects in its collection. And before my boss started, there were 1,000 objects online. And then shortly after he started, there were 10,000. And then he did, the stroke of genius that he did was, nobody in the museum understood what was happening until it was too late. We dropped our pants in public. And what we did was we released all of the metadata for the entire collection. A few things weren't in there because they hadn't been, the credit lines hadn't been checked yet. But we released all of the metadata in public as a CC0 data set. And so what that meant was by the time that I started working at the museum, we rebuilt the collections website, and we simply put everything online. And it's important to understand that at the time, 7% of the collection had been photographed, and the metadata is absolute trash. And I mean, there are things that we don't have a title for it. I still say we, they. They don't have a title for it, they don't have a description, they don't know who made it, they don't have a photograph of it, they're not sure where it's from, they know it's been on exhibition, someone's not entirely confident which shelf it's on, but we know it's a print. And I ran the numbers one day and discovered that there are at least 500 of these objects in the collection. So in effect, what the Smithsonian National Design Museum, and this is like all of your stuff, like really, what we have is a sheath of printing paper. But we put all of those things online anyways, and that was really difficult for a lot of people to understand, but what we were saying was, the thing we're trying to do is to give those objects weight in the universe. Because, and this is really important, like the Cooper Hewitt has 200,000 objects, the Smithsonian has 137 million objects, and they are yours. And the good news is they're all there, and someone is actually taking care of them. And the bad news is the only thing you have is blind faith that I'm telling you the truth. I mean, it would be lovely if we could let everyone run through the stacks in DC, but it's not going to happen. And we don't have enough space or time to rotate everything through the buildings on the mall. So the question is, what then? And what we were saying with the collection was that the value was in giving these things a home on the internet. It's an imperfect solution, but you know, if Ingrid and I can share a link for whatever reason, that starts to create a communal proof around the object itself. And then the good news is it just completed, you know, a couple years ago, a board member wrote a very large check, and they've just completed digitizing every single object in the Cooper Hewitt's collection. And so what that means is those URLs that were mostly just like pointless metadata suddenly now all have images on them. And so it was this idea of trying to make sure that we built a system that was ready to accommodate the possibilities as they came along. So I'll just leave it at that.
And wrapping this up with Matthew Hockenberry, who provided the image that I think is the best thing to leave on display for the duration of this panel, which is why he's going last. Also, I really enjoy Matt's work as it gives a really great kind of like long view historical lens on a lot of this stuff. So.
Yeah, so this is a Western Electric advertisement from 1919 from the Smithsonian, the National Museum of American History, which is not online. And, you know, as a media historian, I have mixed feelings about, you know, putting all this stuff online because it kind of put me out of business. But not really a media historian. I was a researcher at MIT for a long time. We worked on this project called SourceMap, which was about mapping supply chains. And you know, looking at laptops and phones and trying to figure out where they came from proved to be such a weird task that I've spent the last 6 years working on a history of logistics to try to figure out how we got to this place where this is how we make things. And it turns out that in the process of doing that, one of the major cases that, you know, has come up for me is this company, Western Electric, which I sometimes describe as like the Foxconn of its day. But it's not really the Foxconn of its day. It's like the Foxconn plus Apple plus Verizon plus new AT&T. It's like a really complicated, you know, historical actor. And to try to explain how complicated the, you know, Bell system is when you actually look at the financial, social, legal relationships, it's just kind of a mess. But suffice it to say that Western Electric is the company that actually made the equipment that Bell and, you know, the other telephone companies, the Bell licensees, you know, used to, you know, spread telecommunication across the country. So they made the telephones, they made the switchboards, they made the cables, and, you know, for a long time, that how they got into that situation is another complicated story that maybe will come up, you know, in my historical color commentary to the rest of this panel. But the one thing, you know, I do want to say is they directly offer an example of why it's problematic to think about, you know, making the invisible visible, because they show that, you know, this is something that companies and other actors have been trying to do for a very long time. You know, this is an advertisement that's basically trying to show what goes into the telecommunication network in, you know, 1919. And there are ads, you know, earlier, 1910, 1908. And the reason they needed to make these ads was because they had functioned basically as an invisible company, supplying telephones and telephone equipment to Bell, which they were sort of owned by, but not really in the way we would think about it today. But then something happened. All these telephone patents started to expire, right? So in the early 1900s, telephone patents are starting to expire, switchboard patents are starting to expire. So all of a sudden, the previously off-patent telephone suppliers now could sell telephones that were just like Western Electric's telephones. So they had to sort of make a name for themselves. And the way they made a name for themselves was by trying to make the invisible visible, to show how complicated and how materially difficult it was to build America's telecommunication network. And this is, you know, sort of an example of them doing that. And they tried to do this for, you know, 20, maybe 30 years before, you know, they just kind of, you know, fell by the wayside, right? And I think there's a lot of value in thinking about the relationship between their, you know, trying to get people to care about infrastructure in, you know, 1919, and us trying to get people to care about infrastructure in, you know, 2016.
Cool. We only got 20 to 30 years to it. Great. Yeah. Thanks, Matt. That's great. So one of the things that I guess kind of that both like the stuff that Jenna and Aaron and also, Matthew, we're talking about that I think is really interesting is like the kind of weird teasing out of like what, to what extent are like these systems like consequent, like a result of like contingency and intentionality, right? Like why is there a cable in that particular part of Manchester? Like, to some extent, it's a geography thing. Like, it's literally, like, if you draw a line between Hawaii and California, it's the shortest distance. But there's, you know, presumably other reasons. Or similarly, like, with, you know, Aaron, in your experience, like, why is this? Why would the collection be so poorly maintained? Like, who's doing the work? Like, how do these things end up where they end up? And I feel like with the web, it's a lot of things feel kind of like, well, some guy did a thing, and it's 25 years later, and now we're building a civilization on JavaScript. Guy made in 10 days. It's great. But like, that seems like that can't possibly be the whole story. So I guess, is there the question, I guess, I maybe start with Jenna, is like about kind of that balance of like why things end up where they end up, why, like, how systems and infrastructures get built out and excluded from some and others. And then I guess others can respond as they fit.
Yeah, so the person who has documented the fiber optic cables the best is Nicole Starosielski. I think I've said her name correctly, who's not here. We would love to have had her on the panel. And so I'm relying on her research to know what I know about this particular fiber optic cable in Manchester, which is indeed at the nearest distance to Hawaii. That cable, before it was fiber, it was a telegraph cable, and it connected to San Francisco, through San Francisco. It was relocated to Manchester, I think, in the 50s, and it was, not only was it relocated there because of that geographic distance, but because of Cold War era politics, which motivated cable laying to be done in remote areas so that there was less of a target. Or not less of a target, but if it was targeted, there'd be less kind of collateral damage, basically. One of the people I talked to up there pointed out that basically they had this cable that was situated in their community, and they were sort of the acceptable collateral damage. Like, the rural people living by that cable were the people who we could lose if the cable's bombed. There aren't that many of them, so maybe it's okay. And as it relates to access, this person I talked to said, we don't have access to that cable, and we're basically kind of being put in the way of danger without benefiting from it, which, you know, was appalling to her. So the Cold War is over, but that contingency, you know, that kind of happenstance, you know, which dictated that the cable should be there, remains, you know, it remains there. And when they upgraded the cable from coaxial to fiber optic, of course, the kind of path of least resistance is just to do it in the same location. Gradually, there are all these regulations around putting things along the coast. There's the California Coastal Commission. So any kind of change becomes even more and more difficult. And I think, to me, it suggested that there should be this prime opportunity for people to, because they happen to be in this location, right there on this kind of high capacity cable, there should be this unique opportunity to get access to it, right? Kind of an unusually prime opportunity. And it has sort of turned out that way recently. There's have been some efforts in the area to finally tap into that fiber optic cable. A lot of work. I mean, it very late in coming to that area. But that's sort of a picture of kind of the contingencies and happenstance and how it lines up in this region.
So the first time I was doing maps, I was working for a data visualization studio. And one of the things that came up towards the end of my time there was this question about, people tended to look at the work we did and see truth. And that was absolutely not what we were trying to go for. We were like, just it's for feeling the elephant. But the curious thing about data visualization is we don't have the functional equivalent of a legend on a map. We don't have a way to discuss, you know, not like, I mean, the algorithm is the bias is sort of a trope at this point, but we don't have any way to talk to people about the decisions that were made early on. And one of the places that I started thinking about this was public policy. And there's absolutely no way to do this. So people show up at the town hall meeting and they stand there and they're just screaming their head off, and because they're justifiably upset, and it's fine, but they have no way to know that, like, the community went through this last year, and they made choices and decisions. And you see that played out over and over and over again, especially in technology, I think. I mean, at some point, all of this stuff has to dissolve into normalcy, because otherwise we can't get anything done. I mean, there has to be like a, I mean, we can argue the merits of contemporary society, but I would at least posit that contemporary society is predicated on being able to take things for granted. And that's just like layer upon layer upon layer. And then the question becomes where, and there's a limited number of times that you can tell a creation myth about something. And so, you know, the story that I often tell is in the 90s when the web came along, I mean, I was super excited. And I remember thinking, like, I totally want the kids to be able to take this for granted. Like, you should be able to take your phone out and just, like, and have it not be a philosophical moment. On the other hand, and we got it. Like, it happened. And then we also got Facebook. So there's a tension.
Well, I mean, I guess I completely agree with everything. I mean, that's I really want to think about that no equivalent to the map legend, because that's you know, I often think about labels, right, as the made in X, you know, as the that's all you need really to, you know, operate in contemporary society in terms of the level of knowledge about how a thing has been, you know, put together is the made in China, you know, which says everything and nothing, you know, all at once. But the other thing I guess I would say about, you know, the contingent in the sort of historical sense is that it's shocking how much is historically contingent, you know, the decisions that were made, you know, 500 years ago still have ramifications today. And sometimes those decisions seem like reasonable ones and sometimes they just are happenstance. You know, it's where the Portuguese decided, you know, this would be a good place to put a port. You know, turns out to be where we laid telegraph lines, which turns out to be where fiber optic cables go through. And yes, you know, countries and nations and, you know, regimes get built up all around that, and there become social repercussions for, you know, those historical, you know, moments of happenstance, but we're still sort of stuck with them. And, you know, recognizing that, I think, is part of understanding what is flexible about, you know, the way we make things and the way we communicate and the way we produce infrastructure today. You know, lots of people seem to operate under the idea that things are very flexible in, like, say, production, right? You know, but the only part that's really flexible is the, you know, last moment of assembly. You know, all the other stuff is surprisingly inflexible. You know, Western Electric used tin from, you know, Banka Island in Indonesia. They had Chinese labor to make the telephone. Apple, you know, sources tin from Banka Island, Indonesia. They have Chinese labor make the iPhone. You know, some of these things shockingly don't change. And part of, I think, what we need to do is figure out why this hasn't changed, right? You know, these are some weird things that we've been, you know, ignoring that increasingly become problematic in lots of different ways. And it's not about, you know, invisibility, it's about a lack of the ability to tell, you know, the right narratives or to tell the right stories or to have that that opening that you can move into.
Yeah. I mean, just building on that, one of the questions, like, that I'm interested in any of your thoughts on is there's, like, I think a sort of fait accompli quality to technology history. Like, there is a sense that, like, things are not necessarily preordained, but, like, inevitable, and that comes up a lot even in the way that people talk about, I don't know, forecasting out potential things. Like, you know, just once the AI gets good enough, then, like, it's all going to be good. And there's that tendency, the kind of, like, embracing of, like, contingencies like Moore's law as, like, immutable fact. And I guess the question that comes through to this is, like, what in bringing kind of material history in, you know, isolating and viewing very carefully the, like, you know, the human labor that goes into making a Google Street View image, what kind of, like, history is being told instead, or, like, what kind of history does technology history become when it is an infrastructural history? And anyone can take that.
Or what kind of history would you rather be telling?
That it could have been otherwise, you know, that there's not one direct, straight, predictable trajectory and that we can change it, you know, that we can make choices about technology
or that we can adapt things after the fact. I mean, I think some of the interesting things about, you know, like the infrastructure in, that I've seen in Mendocino County is how, like, there's a small wireless internet service provider up there that are, they're making use of things that just are kind of left behind as antennas, to mount their antennas and as towers, and just taking those remnants and turning them into the kind of low-cost infrastructure for a new form of wireless internet service in that community. So I think, you know, the on-the-ground possibilities for kind of adapting and taking advantage of the things that happened to unfold the way they did is an interesting way to kind of twist that and kind of resist a notion of unidirectional, technologically determinist, you know, impact of technology on society. I love this piece by Leo Marx called Technology, the Emergence of a Hazardous Concept, which I have tried to make all my students read. It works best for PhD students. The undergrads, if you work hard, will kind of get the nuance out of it. But part of it is just looking at that word technology and etymologically and seeing that that word has changed, what it means, it has changed over the centuries. And, you know, bringing back the idea that we can make choices about technology rather than accepting that it's a fait accompli.
Yeah, I think on that note, I totally agree. And I think also obviously part of what I'm doing in isolating these structures, it's something like the semantic satiation that happens when you say like a word over and over again. It, the strangeness and specificity of it comes to light. It doesn't, I would hope that someone looking at it can't as easily take these things for granted. And in specifically that they are reflections of a lot of assumptions about maybe like what standards of living we expect, and also capital. So, you know, like these things aren't just there. I think that's how a lot of people experience them day to day. Like there is just a power plant there. It's always been there. But that was built for very specific reasons at a specific time by specific people. And like, I think an obvious example is landfills. I was just on a tour of the San Mateo Recycling Center, and they said something at the end where they were really encouraging everyone on the tour to recycle more because there's a landfill somewhere, it was like near Palo Alto it's the trash from the area around Palo Alto, but it's obviously, I think it's near Half Moon Bay, the actual landfill, and it's about to fill up. So if we don't recycle more, they have to make another landfill, like, and that landfill will be built as a result of actions that were taken, you know, like, and then maybe in the future people will see that landfill and be like, oh, that's the landfill. The landfill's always been there. But it was actually built as a result of things that happen in individual decisions. So, yeah.
Yeah, I just wanted to touch on one of the things that Jenna said, which is, you know, there is absolutely this sort of rhetoric of inevitability around technology these days. And one of the things I've been a little obsessed with is in U.S. law, there's this notion of the exclusionary principle, which is part of the Fourth Amendment. The exclusionary principle is what dictates the admissibility of evidence into a courtroom. And the thing that I find fascinating about it is that the exclusionary principle is quite literally an example of society saying 2 + 2 = 5, right? And then you're like, wait. It's very deliberately saying we don't actually care if something is true, that there is a larger principle at work that outweighs it. And I think right now, I started thinking about this in the context of, you know, big data and just data in general. And the problem that people have right now is that it's all consequence. Like, it's just, if you get hit by all of this stuff, it's just like a scorched earth policy, and there's no way to mitigate the being touched by the data. I mean, you can't make the technology go away. It's not going to. But we also don't have any way as a culture, as a society, to say, it doesn't count. And I think that's an important thing to start thinking about in terms of data and technology in general.
Yeah, I mean, I think I agree with much of the sentiment. You know, the Latourian in me, you know, wants to say that, you know, technology or infrastructure is the social made durable, But, you know, I think it's important to remember that that durability is both material and social, right? We continue to use things. We can change the way we use things. You know, none of the infrastructure that we think about historically was easy to produce. You know, people who are doing startups today and you're struggling for 1 or 2 years, you know, go back and talk to, you know, take your time machine and go back to talk to Samuel Morse or, you know, Alexander Graham Bell, who were shopping around, you know, their technologies, the telegraph and the telephone, for decades, right? Trying to get buy-in, trying to get, you know, the infrastructure built up. You know, those were not easy projects. And the fact that they eventually succeed, although not as to be expected, means that they have a certain kind of historical weight, but that historical weight has proved to be historically contingent itself, right? The telephone famously was not intended to be, you know, sort of the consumer, you know, communication platform that we think of it as. And, you know, that's how people chose to see it, right? That's how it socially evolved. So just to double down on that sentiment that, you know, we have power over these systems in the way that we can choose to see them, choose to interact with them, and choose to build alternatives or new solutions that incorporate them in unexpected ways.
I mean, like, do really though? Like, just like the alternatives thing. Like, it always it sounds. And Aaron, we've talked about this before. The like, the idea of like, you know. I mean, I guess when I hear that, my like knee jerk reaction is like the like romantic promise of the mesh net. The like, if we just, yeah, you know, if we just get enough routers and put them around, like me and, you know, 7 to 10 people will have localized websites that only we can use. This is great. This is great. And that's not a question. That's me arguing. But there, I mean, so actually this is something that I kind of like specifically had wanted to ask you about, which was the way in which, like, if in terms of thinking about like alternatives or like the increasing sense that they're, that like the windows for alternatives are narrowing, which is maybe can choose to agree or disagree about the truth of that with an infrastructure level. Like, could you talk a little bit about like the whole like natural monopoly principle as it applied to Bell? And like, because the thing, and we've, you know, I've talked about this when we initially emailed about this, there's a way in which the degree of abstraction and complexity that is being asked of the system of, like, you know, networked systems today is such that it starts to kind of like almost demand centralization. Or maybe it doesn't, maybe it does. Tell me, please tell me if I'm wrong.
Yeah, I mean, I think it's fair to disagree with your, you know, to start with your disagreement. You know, I always recommend the only really, you know, reasonable book on this topic, which is the Claude Fisher America's Calling book, which is about the social construction of the telephone. Can't say that I'm a huge social constructionist, but, you know, power over technological systems, over infrastructure, is a complicated question. And it's a combination of, you know, willingness to make use of these things and luck and what other actors are doing. So, you know, I'm not saying that every moment that you try to, you know, build a mesh network utopia is going to play out successfully, but, you know, the telephone did become a consumer device, you know, because of historical circumstance and, you know, lots of different actors moving in lots of different ways. As to the sort of naturalness of, you know, monopolies, which, you know, ties back into the, you know, the persistence of infrastructure in some sense, except here it's corporate infrastructure and not, you know, the material infrastructure, although corporate infrastructure is material in lots of ways. There are lots of moments where Bell, which we think of, if we think about Bell at all anymore, you know, seems like a giant company that could never possibly, you know, end until the government has to step in and end this, you know, monster that Bell has become. But Bell, again, is not the kind of monopoly that we would think of today, right? It's a super complicated hybrid organization. It's almost like a historical, you know, anomaly in my mind, on par with like the East India Company. You know, we think of those things as like sort of like organizations that we're familiar with, but they're not. You know, so to say that there's a direct comparison between, you know, Apple or, you know, the Bell system or the East India Company or, you know, feudal governments, you know, they're all so radically, you know, historic in their objectness, as systems and organizations that, I would resist comparisons. So, you know, to say that, you know, Bell is a natural monopoly, well, that's an argument that Bell made at the time, but we can't read it in the contemporary moment in the same way that they would have been making it, you know, and it changes between, you know, say the 60s and the 80s.
Well, I would just mention that universal healthcare is about as centralized as you can get. So, be careful what you wish for.
But this isn't a question about whether centralization is necessarily like centralization, good or bad. Only choose one. More like is it at what point is it necessary, or like who decides that it's necessary? And I think in healthcare, it's like, okay, that's a particular one. But in you know, there is in whatever kind of romantic promise of a web that probably never was, this idea of, you know, the death of whatever J.P. Barlow was talking about 20 years ago, is kind of like that centralization seems like basically just like a final nail in the coffin in that.
I had a thought. So talking to, you know, kind of hardware network people, it sounds to me from the people I've talked to that the centralization of the internet was an inevitability of the internet at scale. And this is why we have these kind of exchange points where every company has all their equipment in one place, which if you're thinking about creating an indestructible network, that's not great, yeah. Right? Also, you know, just the kind of work of like installing towers and finding locations, and that is not easy to do. And one doesn't just have your pick of any place to put a tower by virtue of geography or land ownership or things like that. I mean, I think that's one reason, as I was trying to point out, that the fiber optic cables are where they are and why they're not going to move a whole lot. There's a great piece in this book, the book by Lisa Parks and Nicole Staroselsky. I really hope I'm pronouncing her name right. I practice. Staroselsky?
Yeah.
Okay, Staroselsky. They wrote this edited book. There's a chapter by Paul Derish that looks at the dream of the internet as this decentralized network and the reality of it at scale, and how just managing that magnitude of traffic doesn't work if it's totally decentralized. It's like a material reality of the internet that comes up as a kind of hard stop against the ideal of the internet. And I think the same applies to mesh networks from the network engineers I've spent time with. There's a divide between those who ideologically believe passionately in mesh networks as this perfect example of decentralized build-it-yourself DIY network building, and the guys who are like, no, if you're worried about uptime and if you want a network that stays up and running, you have to plan out routing, and you can't just leave it open to a mesh. So material reality versus ideals. I hate to set up that divide, because I don't think when we're talking about materiality that we should just be talking about constraints. That's the question I usually ask when people start to go down this path. But in this case, I think that's one way to think about the lack of decentralization of the reality of the internet. Yeah, I mean, I think it was in the beginning, you know, I don't know, someone, and we need a historian here who knows about that.
I'm not an internet historian.
Yeah, so we need an internet historian. Is there an internet historian in the house who can tell us how decentralized the internet was in its very beginning? I would imagine it was, and it was sort of, as it scaled, it was like, this is not working, this is breaking, we have to redesign the way we route packets, and we can't leave it open to, yeah. That's a question for the audience. Someone can argue against that. I'm on very unsolid. My footing is it's not solid in making that claim. So,
well, I guess the other part to that is on some levels it depends on how far down the stack, like the traditional OSI stack, to when you get down, like it's still just cables, and tubes, and somebody owns those. So in some level, the internet was always the monopoly of Bell. And then it becomes this tension between public policy and ownership. And, you know, all the arguments about who's allowed to piggyback on top of who else's fiber. I mean, yeah, I think. And then I guess also it's an interesting time right now because I think the tendency is to start to conflate the demands of functionality, so uptime, speed, bandwidth, all the rest of it, with what is it that the internet and the web made possible the day after it existed. And that's not necessarily better television. I mean, for me, I've been trying to think about this in the context of the web. Like, what is it that made the web special? And for me, it's this idea that there is the luxury of recall at the time of one's own choosing. Like, we don't all, it's, you know, before the web, there were basically two modes. There was broadcast television, where we all had to do everything at the same time, or LexisNexis, which was just like a huge financial burden. And the web kind of blew that apart. And that's a manageable thing from an infrastructure perspective, but then suddenly everyone was like, wait, we can do all this other stuff. And now we're sort of thrashing around trying to figure out. Now we're thrashing around because the demands of economics and the demands of systems are starting to come into play. And so I don't know that you can, it is expensive, and so there's a finite number of people who can do it. The cognitive overhead to run these systems is so high that, you know, nobody wants to come, I mean, there's a very small number of people who want to come home at night and be like, you know what I'm going to do? I'm going to pry my router open.
If I can just add one more little thing. You know, so I want to push back, I guess, a little bit on the, like, centralized versus distributed as like the dichotomy that we should be thinking about, because I think if we start thinking about did the internet have to be, you know, a centralized structure? Does it have to, you know, become a pseudo U.S. government controlled, you know, monopolistic thing in a way that we think about Bell historically as maybe like this natural monopoly? It makes it easy for us to forget the complexities of different kinds of actors working within the central structure. Like, so this picture, you know, Bell is not quite the monopoly that we would think of it, of the late Bell, you know, the Bell of the 70s in 1919, but there's not a lot of real competition. The opposition telephone movement, which are all these, like, originally off-patent, but now as the telephone patent, you know, the original sets of telephone patents begin to expire, they start competing. They're competing at economically, you know, a very low level, but they definitely change the way Western Electric and Bell start to think about themselves, right? They definitely alter, you know, Western Electric starts to think of itself as needing to be a public company talking about, you know, telecom infrastructure to, you know, a public, which is maybe not the same kind of public we think about today, but is, you know, a much broader constituency than, you know, what had happened before. So looking at, even within these centralized structures, the complexities of how actors are moving around within those organizations or networks and responding, you know, I think is an important part of telling the story.
So just being mindful of time, I guess we could maybe open the floor up to questions if there are any. Oh, there are some. And I think I was told that you can just holler and or this mic will pick you up. So I don't know if that means we need to pass the mic or not. And the nice man who would tell me otherwise is gone. But hello, yes. Yes, sure. Yes.
There's this guy, Ted Nelson, who in the 60s developed Project Xanadu, which was like an attempt to be more decentralized about how data was transferred. And it's kind of considered like the oldest vaporwave. Vaporware. That's funny. But actually, like, because gets to the legacy of like causality or whatever you want to call it. A lot of the early technology built into the internet was being financed by Xerox. They were very opposed to the idea that like the idea of copying would go away. Like, why do you need to copy all these files between computers when literally the point of networking is to share them? Xerox is kind of opposed to that, so that's why we have this paradigm of like sending a copy of something rather than actually.
useful. Yeah, yeah. Other questions? Right.
Just, I don't know if it's a question or a remark, anecdote, actually, but the decentralized or centralized happens sometimes not on the level of infrastructure. Alexander Galloway has this argument about how control is done through algorithms, and then something could be highly controlled exactly when it's very decentralized. So how would you gather that into this dichotomy of below and ground and on the big table?
Who wants to
speak?
Just as a quick comment, I like that, because I think it's easy to sort of fall in, if we're all talking about a lot of like physical infrastructure or in the internet, the physical layer, right? Like the cables and the towers. And I think it's not useful to then treat the software level like, oh, everything's possible there, everything and anything. It's just the hardware that's constraining us. And that, I think, is the wrong way to think about it. And so bringing kind of algorithmic design and kind of software into the conversation about materiality is important. That's the only comment I have about it. But.
And also maybe like the humans, right? Like the 2 weekends ago at Stevens University, there was a really fantastic conference on like maintenance and systems. And the point was made that kind of maintenance is where technology is revealed to be a socio-technical system. The sense that like someone has to produce these objects, someone has to be in a factory making material things. Things need to be like exist in the world, and those are constraints as well, and they're not easily removed. Yes.
So I wanted to make like a possibly hilarious plug for democracy. in part because, as far as the internet goes, I don't think it's a binary centralized decentralized space. It's a hybrid. Part of the reason why is because internet service providers, which are corporations, came in and claimed space and said, hey, we have the capital to build large nodes in the network, and we're going to sell you access to our hubs, right? That's why we have a handful of ISPs, service providers. But that can kind of overstep its boundaries. I think it's a little troubling sometimes to say, like, we don't like the way the system is, so we're just going to create a alternative from scratch. I think there is an avenue towards regulating ISPs and sort of corporate control of the internet, and that's government. And people forget about that sometimes. But I work for the state government, actually, and we work really hard to try and, like, claim space back from corporations. And part of the way that we do that is through public participation, which is really important. The internet, indeed, has been regulated as a public utility. Like, that's a win. So I think we should think a lot about, when we talk about alternatives, like looking at the structures that exist for public access to changing the system. I think that there's possibilities there that sometimes we forget about.
Just to piggyback on that, so I worked at an ISP in the 90s, and I've forgotten the exact legislation, but the story that I always heard was that in the late 80s, there was legislation that made its way through Congress that effectively said that any individual or corporation could purchase phone lines from the phone company and simply peg them for 24/7, just hold them open. And in 1988, the phone companies were like, whatever. Sure, whatever, right? And so this is this, you know, and then suddenly the law of unintended consequences kicked in, and ISPs happened, and that was a big deal for the phone companies. They spent the 90s, like, panicking. One, for the revenue model, and two, just trying to keep the infrastructure up. And, you know, so you see, since then, the phone companies basically doing everything in their power to prevent that from ever happening, which is one side of the equation. And the other one is that, you know, as a community, as a society, when we pass these laws, how far do we go to be like, I don't know what's going to happen, but we're doing this on principle, rather than being like, we will predetermine every possible outcome before it starts.
Does anyone have a question? All right, that hand went up very rapidly, so I'm going to see if it's an anecdote or not.
I think it is.
Cool. Great. I mean, these have all been fantastic. I just want to make sure if there are like specific things.
So this question is for Aaron, but I guess I'm curious for any of the panelists. don't have a way to either validate or contextualize this representation of information. And like, please correct me if I'm wrong, but I just don't agree with that. So I wanted to get maybe like a little bit more information on where you're coming from with that, because it seems like whether you're, like if you're a cartographer, you have this responsibility to like create a key for your maps that contextualizes it. And it seems like if you're creating data visualizations, why is that not the case as well? And why do you see it as inherently devoid of that sort of contextualization?
Oh, my point was just that we haven't figured out what the equivalent of a map legend is. We don't have the language, visual or otherwise. We don't have the shorthand that a map legend serves, acts as, for DataViz. DataViz just sort of gets presented, you know, sort of as like it's just, you know, the voice of God speaking. I mean, we never did it. I mean, I've never seen anyone do it. I mean, you never see any of, you know, data visualization is sort of the perfect seamless experience. You never see the sausage being made. It's just, you know, beautiful.
Around jobs and internet. Yeah. This is just vaguely connected to kind of Marxist thought, but there is a lot of work emerging now that's all about kind of uncovering that hidden labor that makes these seemingly automated systems run and, you know, surfacing it. And I think there's just a really interesting conversation going on. I think I've heard people talking about it here, about things very consciously rendered as automated such that all of the human labor going into it is concealed to kind of give technology this seemingly kind of overwhelming power that's not accurate, you know? And some of that gets down to like kind of labor exploitation or how, there's really interesting work by Lily Irani on Mechanical Turk workers and kind of the conditions under which they work. And I mean, that's a prime example. And actually, Amazon's not even subtle about it. They call it Mechanical Turk, which essentially the metaphor is, you know, a platform that looks like it's automated and actually has humans secretly behind it, operating it. I think there are lots of people working in that space. Other comments?
I'll just say that I think this is one huge benefit of tours, like tours of any kind of infrastructure, is because you see the people inside. And like I said earlier, it's a problem that I have with some of my earlier work, where it's this like, you know, bird's eye view of a structure, and it's like looks very technological and looks very clean, and there's like, it's very advanced or whatever. And you can't see the actual people inside, and like it doesn't matter how high tech it is. There are people who work in there, and I also another thing that I'm really wary about with myself, but kind of this whole like, I don't know, like, I think it's just really easy to fetishize infrastructure. It's like, I get excited about it, but it's like, oh, tubes and pipes, but it's not like that for people who work there. And I mentioned going to a data center, without going into too much detail, there was a video being made of this data center by people who are very excited about the data center, myself included. And the people who worked there were really kind of annoyed. They were like, what is fascinating about this to you? And then like I asked some question like, oh, like what's
what's further over there? And they're like, more servers. It looks exactly like this. It's like, it's like, identical, you know, like I don't, they're like, I don't know why you're interested in this. And so like the position that I have definitely risked being in with some of my work is this kind of like, I have the privilege of being fascinated with infrastructure because I don't work there and I'm far away from it, you know, a lot of the time. So.
Yeah, all the interiors, like all happy data centers look alike, right? And I mean, the thing I'm like mostly curious about, and I can't imagine, I don't know how much you dig into, is like the coal plant data center like positioning is really interesting and kind of why a data center ends up where it ends up and like what kinds of brokering goes into that is like a story that I'm not sure entirely how to tell visually, but it's a really compelling piece of the whole thing. And a part of that kind of like larger labor and superstructure that kind of makes these networks possible.
Yeah, I definitely see my work as Marxist, you know, in nature. The alternative image that I could have shown one day, which is how I latched on to Western Electric as an interesting historical actor. One day, Mara Mills, who's a professor who does history of the telephone, also disability studies, handed me this document called Far Corners of the Earth, which was a publication that Western Electric put out a couple times in the 20s into the 30s. That has this cover of the telephone and then all these caricatures of, you know, people with, you know, straw hats and like all the workers, right? But they're not pictures, they're just caricatures. And it goes through and it tells the story, but the story of the telephone for them is the story of the materials. And there are all these pictures and workers appear there, but they're never interesting, right? The only interesting worker is the workman at Chicago who's assembling the telephone. You know, this picture has operators. We can't see their face. You know, there's, you know, I always...
Hands are those.
The hands of the servant, who is also God. You know, there's all this weird stuff. You know, I always, you know, when I teach telephone history, I always show Phantom the Operator, which is the Carolyn Martell kind of trippy, you know, story of the telephone operator basically ceasing to exist, that labor, you know, being, you know, becoming, you know, a phantom, haunting, you know, the infrastructure of the telephone. I mean, is evocative in a way that I enjoy. So,
I'm curious, I guess, about like the aspect of like digital develop and whether or not that deserves a physicality or like a appreciation. Like we've been talking a lot about Marx. I'm curious about like Mark Zuckerberg instead, and like what the presence of the network is like as a the thing inside of the data center is all these abstract connections and relationships, and I'm curious how that factors back into this question.
Is this the parallel flicker?
I think that might be a good moment for parallel flicker. And Private Square also, because I think both are great. So if you could, I don't know, do you want?
Yeah. So what's the quick way to do parallel flicker? So I worked at Flickr for a million years, one of the things that we were able to do for a short time anyways was enjoy basically everyone's trust. And I recommend it. It's pretty incredible to build something like that, which meant that like nobody ever backed their photos up, ever. And I always back my photos up on principle, and so the genesis of Parallel Flickr was this idea of, you know, for a couple of years I had just bags of files, and I was like, what am I supposed to do? So if you start from the extreme failure scenario that tomorrow Flickr goes away, it's just offline. And when I say Flickr, just replace it with Instagram, Facebook, Twitter, whatever. And so I started building, on top of the Flickr API, this thing called Parallel Flickr that would download all of my photos and all of the metadata and all of my favorites and essentially rebuild the site in a kind of, you know, living, breathing archive, but that was never perfect. It was never meant to compete in terms of interface or functionality. But at least it was something. And there was this idea that, you know, in the worst case scenario, I could, you know, send my mom an email and be like, well, replace flickr.com with my website.com. And the URLs were all the same. And Private Square was, Private Square was the sort of inverse of this. So if Parallel Flickr was like an archive, Private Square was a looking glass archive in the sense that it was meant to do the same thing for Foursquare, but the way it worked was You know, it was fine. I don't, you know, everybody loves Dennis because, you know, Dennis is great. But I was like, I don't mind telling Dennis Crowley that I'm at a bar, but I don't know that he needs to know that I'm at the pharmacy. But maybe I'd like to know that I'm at the pharmacy. And so the way Private Square worked was you would check into Private Square and then check into Foursquare. And Parallel Flickr, just to go back to that, the way it worked was it piggybacked on top of the API. And so you would log in via the Flickr API. So, you know, the site knew who you were, and by extension, it knew who your contacts were. And so you were able to preserve the private, public nature of photos. And then the corollary to that, and I keep trying to find, you know, someone in the museum world to actually do this, was what does it mean for, you know, one museum to run their own instance of Parallel Flickr, get people to authenticate through it. And maybe it's only for people in, you know, Queens. Maybe you've got to show your ID somewhere or whatever. And you start to be able to archive and preserve just a tiny subsection of it. Because Flickr's, you know, Flickr was already big. It's only gotten bigger. The idea of trying to archive Facebook is almost unimaginable. And a huge part of that is the social interactions. So I could keep going, but I feel like maybe it's...
I mean, I guess so in terms of how that ties back to that question, I don't know, one of the reasons that I really love that project is it suggests like a weird sort of like, you know, exit hatch or like escape hatch from a lot of, like, if there's like complexities of like kind of these, the network spaces or of like the large behemoth spaces, the ability to kind of manipulate their own kind of like manipulate like their own services to be able to like use them as you would like see fit. So I don't know if that's helpful to your question, but cool. Yes.
So I was kind of interested, though, if that sort of maybe distracts from, like, for instance, like the sneakernet, that idea, if that is maybe in itself some kind of manifestation of the mesh network. If I don't know if that, so that's part one of the question. And the other part was just because there is that interest in decentralization, that there is now some instances of corporations starting to look into this, like I just as a couple examples, like Netflix has been looking into web torrents. I guess it's a little bit up the stack, but for, you know, streaming, or, you know, Microsoft is using distributed updates, so you get updates from other people's computers. If those might be manifestations of the mesh network that aren't being recognized, or that could be
the
first word you said, privatization.
Yeah, well, like that it's being used, like typically, I guess you think of mesh networks or distributed kinds of systems to be more open source, but now it's kind of being so much privatized. Yeah.
I guess I kind of want to push back on, there is a certain fetishization of decentralization that I'm not sure is useful. I mean, decentralization is great for a lot of things, but sometimes it just doesn't work. And sometimes, like, and I think just coming back to this idea that a lot of these things are social, a lot of these things are what we as a community agreed to do and to treat as a baseline. I would love it if we could have network infrastructure that you didn't have to feel creepy about, just simply as a social good. And like, we have done this, and we do it with plumbing.
Well,
No, but like, literally plumbing.
Yeah, but I mean, Michelin, dude.
Yeah, but nobody's sitting around saying like, that was a good thing, okay, right? I mean, there's a tension, there's a way to do it badly. Yeah. But I guess Flint is sort of maybe the example of, you know, if you go to the bathroom and you press the button and the bad stuff doesn't go away, all semblance of normalcy simply ceases until that problem fixes itself. Right? And so we've done this before. As a community, as a society, we have said plumbing is a baseline. And when things like Flint happen, people are like, that's really bad. And so, I mean, with a network, with the kinds of things we want to do on a network, I'm not sure how you get away from a measure of centralization, and I don't know that it's bad a priori.
We have like 1 minute left, so I guess if anyone has further comments on that. Or
I mean, I guess I'll just bring Alex Galloway back, you know, and the protocol argument. I mean, even when you have decentralized, distributed, you know, networks, if you have, you know, a certain level of mechanics, I guess I'll say, instead of protocols, right? You know, it's the centralization, you know, in the head, right? I mean, it's like the central power structure that set those protocols might be there, even if it appears decentralized. So, yeah, I mean, talking about decentralization is, you know, is complicated, I guess, right? It's not something that you can say, oh, this is definitely decentralized, and there's no, you know, power here in this network, right? You know, networks are uneven, and, you know, Facebook definitely demonstrates that.
So everything is complicated. Death comes for us all, and I want to thank all of you, and thank you all for participating. It's such a delight to have the four of you on a stage together. And, yeah, I think we're now have to clear out of here for the next session, probably. All right. Oh, really? Okay, I mean, we can hang out, but, like, I kind of feel bad. I don't want to make you guys do that.
I know.
Oh, okay.
I recognize your name. I was like, ah.